The bottom line is that Dr. Bredesen has given us a way to, one, identify what is actually wrong with us and heal from the inside out. He's given us, if I'm understanding this correctly, a way to take charge and not only prevent, but reverse dementia and Alzheimer's for the first time ever, if what I'm reading, I'm interpreting correctly.
That is 100% correct.
Did you push record?
Thank you so much for tuning into our second act with Paige and Silke. Today we have a very important topic that has bound to have touched you in some form or fashion. And I'm so excited to introduce you to Dr. John DeWitt. John, thank you so much for joining us today.
Well, thank you for having me. I'm very excited to talk about the latest research on this topic, and hopefully we can help your viewers as much as possible.
Oh, I hope so too. By way of introduction, Dr. DeWitt is a former NFL player. He's a best-selling author and a public speaker, and with a combination of his own experience as a player with concussions and his current struggle with his father, struggling with dementia, he is on a path to pursue the latest advancements in cognitive decline research and treatment. And that's where I loved what I read. I loved the podcast I just listened to. How do we have hope finally on this? Dr. DeWitt, explain that.
Well, Dr. Dale Bredesen came out with a book, and I actually have it right here. It's The End to Alzheimer's. And ironically, my sister found that book because she is in Alabama, which is closer to where my dad is, because he's suffering with dementia and a variety of other things. And she referred me to this book. And he has been working on this for 28 years. He's a Duke University graduate. He spent some time at MIT, at Caltech, and now he's up at UCLA and has been trying and realizing that the 20th century approach to medicine, the monotherapeutic, there's one magic pill to cure everything. They've been spending billions and billions and billions of dollars on Alzheimer's through that route and hundreds of research studies. And none of them have really turned out anything. I think out of all those hundreds of studies, they came out with two medications that kind of work, but they only are symptom relief, but it doesn't actually focus on the cause. And so he said, there has to be a better way. And so he approaches it as, instead of a magic bullet, he looks at it as magic buckshot. So because there's multiple things, I think he's come up with 46 different things that can lead to Alzheimer's and cognitive decline. And so he has an entire protocol called the ReCODE Protocol that, based on the different type of Alzheimer's you could have, he breaks it into four types. The first type is on inflammation. Chronic inflammation is what causes that. And then there's a type 1.5 that's all insulin dependent. That's when you have the diabetic patients that have issues because glucose is not being absorbed properly. You have high insulin levels, and there's an enzyme that focuses on breaking down that insulin, but it also breaks down the amyloid plaqueing. But if it's spending all its time breaking down the insulin, then it's not going to be breaking down the amyloid plaques. And even though they used to think that was the main cause of Alzheimer's, they're realizing now it's the body was just being smart because it's trying to protect your brain from any chronic inflammation or toxins and things like that. Type two is where you have a lack of trophic factors, such as you're not getting enough vitamin D, your thyroid hormone levels are too low, you're not getting enough sleep. That's something I thought was really interesting. Is there's a lot of people that have sleep apnea and don't even realize it. And that's when you stop breathing multiple times throughout the night while you're sleeping. And that can just cause all kinds of issues with your hormones and stress levels. And so that's type two. Type three, what is type three? Well, technically it's type three because we had the type 1.5, but I can't count. I can't count anymore. But type three, this is really interesting because type three is when you have, can be from any infection. It can be from bacterial infection. They focus a lot, not just only on the gut, but the blood-brain barrier and the nasal sinus passages, because any kind of, if you're working in a toxic environment that has mold, you might not even know it. And those spores get up into your sinus cavity, and that is a direct link to your brain that can cause a lot of issues. And everybody used to think, okay, we know that the genetic marker you want to look for is the APOE4 marker. And if you're positive for that. Oh my gosh, horrible things. But it's interesting because when you take it back to where that, when that allele originally started, it was the one of the very first things that happened. He's very big into evolution and that kind of stuff. So he says that when we came out of the trees from the arboreal type existence and started walking on the savannas, we needed that particular allele, because if we stepped on something, cut our foot and got dirt and stuff up in there and that bacteria, it actually has a pro-inflammatory response. And so that helps us to survive longer. And also it helps us live longer without as much food, because it helps us to break down and absorb fats better. So if you are positive, well, if you aren't positive for APOE4, then you have about a 9% chance of lifetime risk of getting Alzheimer's. If you do, if you have one copy of it from one of your parents, you have a 30% chance, increased chance of getting Alzheimer's. And if you have both copies, you have over a 50% chance or risk of getting Alzheimer's. But it's not necessarily good or bad. And he points that out. He's like, it's just APOE4 is not necessarily going to be good if you have type 1, type 1.5, or type 2. If you have type 3, which is from an infection, that's actually what it's for. And back in the day when we first had that, we were homozygous. We've had two copies. Everybody, 96% of the population millions of years ago had both copies of the APOE4 because they needed it for existence and survival. So anyway, that's my long answer. Sorry.
Well, and so let me dummy it down just a little bit.
Sorry.
Because what I love about you, you have already, you know, taken some very complicated information, and you are, I don't dummy it down, but make it more simplified for your listeners, our viewers. The bottom line is that Dr. Bredesen has given us a way to, one, identify what is actually wrong with us and heal from the inside out. He's given us, if I'm understanding this correctly, a way to take charge and not only prevent, but reverse dementia and Alzheimer's for the first time ever, if what I'm reading, I'm interpreting correctly.
That is 100% correct. And he has seen over 250 cases of people that have, they spoke multiple languages, and once they got the symptoms of Alzheimer's, they couldn't speak those languages anymore. They went on his protocol. 5-6 months later, they were able to bring those languages back. So it's still in there. You just can't access it. And when you follow and know, he has a laundry list of blood work you need to do and what the different goal target things are. And we'll talk about those in later shows. But you need to know, because you need to know where you are. And if you have plenty of vitamin D, that's great. Then you don't need to worry about taking a vitamin D supplement. Or if your thyroid levels are okay, then you don't have to worry about that. But it's always good and a lot less stressful when you know where you are, especially if you have someone in your family that's been suffering with Alzheimer's. It's just good to know.
Exactly. And at the same time, it's like you don't want to deal with it. And
again,
this fits so perfect for our show, not only because our audience is at that, you know, in that time of our life, we've either been caregivers, it's very close to home. I was a primary caregiver for my father with dementia or Alzheimer's. My grandmother died of Alzheimer's. I'm right in line. Yeah. And I have not, I'm one of those people that doesn't really want to know if I have that gene. And by after reading and listening to your podcast, it's okay, because we do have a way. We might be able to reverse this. It looks like there's something we can do. And I think that's one of the biggest pieces of hope that I want to leave our audience with in this segment, you know, as we introduce you and introduce this topic, that, you know, stay with us, because we're going to be talking about specific ways to know where you are and then what you can do about it. Dr. DeWitt, we are coming to the end of this first segment. What can we leave our audience with, you know, to sum up this particular segment?
Well, to sum up, if they want to know if they are APOE4 positive, you can go to 23andMe.com, and that's just kind of like an Ancestry.com type thing, and they have specific tests for that. And so that way you can find out, and then you know what your risk is, and you know there's specific nutritional changes that we'll talk about in future segments that will help optimize your health based on your genetic makeup.
Okay. Thank you so much. And we'll see you on our next segment. We're going to hold you over and talk a little bit more specific as to how we take charge and live our life to the fullest after 50, because dementia is definitely not going to let us do that. See you in our next segment.
Thank you.
Thanks so much for watching, and I hope you found today's segment helpful. For more information on this very important topic, please visit our website, secondact.tv. I've also provided links to all of Dr. DeWitt's information below. And if you haven't done so, please be sure to subscribe to our channel. Button's right over here. Thank you.